Good morning, everyone.
This is a really big room, so it's nice that everybody could come out on Friday morning, the last day of the conference. 9 a.m., first thing. All right, so I want to start a little bit with my background. I was a security practitioner for a number of years, and I worked in cryptography. And I thought cryptography was going to solve everything, right? You can encrypt your data, you can throw it out there, and it's secure. But then I realized that the security breaks down around the math, around the cryptography. And that got me really interested then in this topic of risk, trying to analyze and measure risk. And that led me down this path of trying to understand, how do we actually measure security? How do we measure risk? And that eventually led me to statistics. And that is how I got here today. And so during my career, I spent about 4 years working at Verizon on the data breach investigations report. About a year and a half ago, I left and I went to BitSight, where I'm working as a data scientist, which is just the new term for statistician. And let me see if this works here. So I'm going to start with the takeaways. This is what, at the end, I hope that you walk away with. And throughout the talk, I'm not going to dwell on these, but these are the underlying tones that I hope people walk away with. So science, data science, this works, right? Especially with the noisy data that we have and the complexity that we have in our environment. Taking a very scientific approach is, I think, a very, very solid way to proceed. A little signal can go a long way, and I'm going to talk about some of the weak signals and some of the relationships that I'm able to find in data and what we can pull from that, and that little signal is going to go a long way. Next, I think that we need to adopt this learn from data mentality. As we're having these conversations in security and trying to understand, you know, where do we spend our budget, how do we allocate our resources, I think we need to start challenging how we know things. When somebody says, we must do this, say, how do you know? How can we validate that, or even disprove it in some cases? And lastly, I think we need to start building up data literacy and data skills. Usually when I do talks, I try to focus on that part. And I say, hey, here's how you can do it in your environment. I'm not going to do that today. I'm actually just going to talk about some of the cool data stuff that I get to work with day in and day out. So I wanted to start out and just talk about some of the data that I get to work with. And these are just sort of examples, sort of to wet the whistle, if you will. So this is taking a look at ransomware. And so obviously ransomware has been a large topic, especially this week. And I think that there's still a lot of disagreements on, do you pay the ransom, do you not? You know, how successful are backups, so on and so forth. But this is about 6 months ago that I did this study. And at the time, and I think a little bit to this day, there was a lot of talk about healthcare being targeted by ransomware. And so this is data from a sinkhole. So this is several ransomware families connecting out, trying to contact home, and so it's contacting a sinkhole infrastructure instead. And so you can see the distributions on the left here across the industries. Education, about 13% of the industries that we were tracking, or 13% of the educational institutions, had some form of ransomware. And you can see healthcare is actually third on the list, and it's pretty much tied with energy utilities, retail, things like that. Finance, very, very low down on there. And so this is the type of thing, even though you see headlines saying healthcare is being targeted, we might want to challenge that. We might want to say, hey, maybe it isn't ransomware, maybe it's not healthcare. Data is going to help inform us. This is another look. This is looking at DMARC, the rollout of DMARC. And DMARC is used for email authentication. It's going to improve phishing attacks, spam, things like that. So the more companies that roll out DMARC, the harder it's going to be for phishers and scammers. And so what we're seeing, the chart in the lower right here with the points and the lines, what's interesting is the rate of rollout. The bottom right, I don't know if you can read that, but that's retail in the bottom right, where it's a much higher proportion of companies in retail, and it's at a much higher rate. So it's rolling out quicker in retail, right? And then the bars on the left are comparing 2015 to 2016. And you see everybody's going up. That's not the surprise, but it's more about the rate and the amount. And so like if you compare retail to healthcare, for example, healthcare is not really rolling out. But if you think about it, where phishing and a lot of the type of attacks like that, it's more in the retail and the finance, which is in the upper right. Now, this is looking at Heartbleed. And so this is taken from internet scans on a pretty routine basis. And when I submitted my slides for RSA and I got feedback from them, and the feedback on the slide, well, this is like head-slappingly obvious, of course Heartbleed is going down. Right? And that's not at all what this slide is trying to communicate. It's talking about the rate of change. And so if you take a look at something like retail again, which is in the bottom left, second from the right, that flat line essentially, retail has largely tackled Heartbleed. It's doing very, very well with Heartbleed. You take a look at something like education and the right above that, there's still a lot of work to do in education. Education is generally more of an unmanaged environment. You've got a lot of students, a lot of student projects, things like that. And so this is why what we want to look at here is that rate of change, which is really interesting. And a lot of this, these are straight lines, but this is probably something where it came out and there's a lot of patching going on. It's going to do this and it's going to even out like this. And so what we're kind of looking at a snapshot where it appears more linear, but it's probably more of a long tail type of thing. So the data that I look at on a daily basis, there's a lot of data that I get to work with, and it's really fun to do it. So this is the statistics of the data that I get to work with, about 50 billion daily events that come into our systems. We've got over 100 different unique data feeds feeding into that, and we've got over 70,000 companies that we're tracking. Now, when I say tracking, what we have is a team of people that manually will find a company and map their IP space. And so when we see an IP address, when we see something connecting up to a sinkhole, for example, we're able to tie that to a company. And then with demographics about that company, we can then talk about industry trends. And because we're tying it to specific companies, we can now combine data sets. And we can look at correlation across data sets that you wouldn't be able to if you keep things anonymous. So the goals of the studies, obviously we're going to look across all of these companies. But then what we want to do is that we want to look at things that we can observe and compare them to the bad things, right? Breaches or events that happen. And malware outbreak is an indication as I'll talk about, an indication of maturity. And so what we want to do is we want to use these sort of bad signals or bad events, things that we'd like to avoid, as the measuring stick. And we want to use that measuring stick to determine the effects of other things, the other data that we're able to collect. So I'm going to walk through three different studies. One is where I looked at trying to observe maturity, which I'll define in a little bit here. The second one I'll actually talk about is the attack surface. How can we measure attack surface and actually see how good or bad having a large attack surface is. And then I'm going to end on monoculture, which is a really, really fun topic, and it's a very rich topic to discuss. Now, as we go through these studies, it's a very natural thing to expect perfection, right? As you look at these, it's very easy to look at the data sources, at some of the outcomes, and say, there's flaws in here. The data is not 100%, things like that, and it never will be. We will never have perfect data. So it's very natural to think, though, to think, hey, this is imperfect. But what we have to do, we have to compare any new thing that we're trying to research and trying to study to where we are currently, right? So if we're trying to measure maturity of a company, the security maturity, we have to compare it to the methods we have now, right? And this is the SigLight questionnaire. And nothing in SigLight, but this is what we're doing now, right? What we do is to measure the maturity of a company, we're going out, we're giving them a questionnaire. They're taking the time to fill it out, or they're giving us something that they've already filled out. And then we have to go through that questionnaire and assign some type of meaning to the answers, which brings us to the next problem of what we're currently doing, right? This is the ever-popular risk matrix, which is largely subjective. And anybody who's had to work with this type of thing knows some of the debates that goes into Is this a medium? Is this a high? And all the joys associated with it. So as we talk about the type of analysis I'm doing, this is our measuring stick now. This is what we want to compare the results to. Is it better than this? And now, I mentioned how subjective some of the current methods are. And I want to talk about intuition for a bit and how we use intuition in security and the strength of data analysis when it comes to that. So this is Stephen Few, and he's got this quote. Stephen Few is known for, he discusses data visualization a lot, several books on the topic. And he says, I respect the value of a well-honed intuition. I personally trust a strong intuitive sense of what's going on, of what will work and what won't. That is rarely wrong. Rarely wrong, but wrong enough to keep me humble. And this is, I absolutely love this quote. And this is something working with data. There are things that I go into analysis with and I'm thinking, oh, it's gotta be this way. I'm gonna look at this data and here's the outcome. And every once in a while, I am completely shocked. And I am made very humble, right? Because the data is correcting me. It's correcting my intuition. And I think that sort of mentality is what we need. We need to be able to be humble and to be challenged on what we think is true. So the first study I want to go into, so hopefully I painted the frame around what we're going to get into. So the first one is modeling maturity. And so what we want to try and look at is can we look at possibly trying to do better than those questionnaires? Or how can we measure some mature aspect of companies externally? So the first thing to look at is botnet infections, right? This is malware that tries to phone home. It phones home to a sinkhole infrastructure. And the first thing, well, let me describe what you're looking at here. So this is all the companies that we're tracking. And along the bottom is the number of malware infections per employee over a 12-month period. And so you can see like 1 out of 100, 1 out of 10. You get one, that's one infection per employee per year on the far right of the distribution. And so this is, what's interesting about this is a couple of things. The big thing is that there's a pattern, right? This is not random noise. It starts on one side and it goes up and it kind of slopes down the other side, and that's awesome, right? We're seeing a pattern already, right? And we can do things like, you know, in the middle here we got about one C2 botnet infection for every 400 employees on average in this data set. And so if you think about that, think about how many employees at your company. If you're in the middle here in the typical company, you're about one for every 400 employees. Now we can look at this data, and then we can look at another data set. This is looking at peer-to-peer file shares. There we go. And again, it's another distribution. Now there's a challenge in some of the demographics. You see we've got some tall lines in there. And it's also in the previous one. But what that is, we've got, when we record the number of employees at a company, companies will say, you know, if they're about 950 or 1,050, they're going to say 1,000. And so we get these striations in the employee count, which makes some of these lines tall. But again, we're seeing a pattern here. And if we just focus on this for a second, we can look at how does peer-to-peer file sharing spread across industries, right? And this is the interesting aside. So at the very top is education, right? Again, it's more of an unmanaged network. And what this is, the actual point, the diamond there, is what the data is saying. Our confidence, the margin of error, is in that gray bar. So you can see education has a lot of peer-to-peer file sharing going on. Tourism and hospitality is second. Third comes government and politics, which I think is pretty interesting. And then if you go down to the bottom there, you see legal and finance on the bottom. Typically, peer-to-peer file sharing is copyrighted material. It's applications, games, movies, things like that, songs. And so legal and finance on the bottom shouldn't be surprising. Legal because it's generally copyrighted, and finance because they generally have some of the better controls in place. So if we take this peer-to-peer file sharing now, and let's look and compare that to botnet infections. And when we put them on a single plot, this is what we see. So each point here is a company. And it's looking at, and then I tried to color in the density so that green to yellow is where there's a lot of companies in there. And so we're looking at the number of peer-to-peer file shares per employee along the bottom, and then the number of botnet infections per employee on the top. And this is a really strong correlation. Anytime you see the data go from the left to the right like that, really strong correlation. And again, this is correlation, not causation, right? Because all we're seeing at this point is that when you see this, you will probably also see this go up, right? But to try and get at the causation, we actually did a study where we grabbed a bunch of applications and games off of there, the executables, and we looked for malware. We scanned them for malware. And essentially, we found about 2 out of every 5 executables contain malware on peer-to-peer file sharing. Now again, it's hard to say causation, it's hard to prove causation with data, but this is really strong evidence. So if you are not blocking peer-to-peer, it's something to strongly consider because we're seeing this malware being spread through there. Now we're gonna take a look at several variables. This is actually a study that we wrote a paper up on with a good friend of mine, Ben Edwards. And so in the upper left, you see the botnet infections. In the middle, we've got the peer-to-peer file shares. The one in the upper right, we looked at SSL services and the percent of the SSL services being offered that were misconfigured somehow. And that is, you know, they're using a, trying to negotiate using a broken protocol, you know, SSL v2, something like that. They're trying to use a set of cipher suites that is known to be flawed, some of the export ciphers, things like that. And so the one in the upper right, what's interesting is that there's probably a good 3 patterns in there. Right? You see that there's at 0%, companies that are doing really well, and it kind of slopes down a little bit. Then you get this big, the thing going up, and then it drops off suddenly around 75%. Then you get that little peak at 100%. Some companies have 100% of their SSL services with some kind of flaw or misconfiguration. In the lower left, we're looking at SSL certificates, certificate management. So these could be flawed in some way of being expired. They're using a weak signature algorithm, small keys, something like that. And this is the percent of the certificates that they have that have some kind of a flaw or problem. And again, you see it's a nice distribution. Then you see some set of companies with just 100% bad certificates or flawed in some way. In the bottom one, we've got reasonable services. And these are everything that security people would push you towards. So these are almost all the services with an S on the end, right? SMTPS, HTTPS, LDAPS, POP3S, things like that. And so these are all the encrypted ones. And these would be good, right? These are considered good generally. The last one is risky services. And these are all the services that security people would never allow to be exposed to the internet, right? You've got Telnet, file shares like SMB, database services. These are things that you would never want to open up directly to the internet, things that are sending passwords in the clear. So if we look at these distributions, and then what we can do is pick out a specific company and a specific event. So here's a company that had a very large breach in which their database was compromised. And the red lines here show where they are. They had a huge number of botnet infections, very, very large. They had a whole bunch of peer-to-peer file shares, and again, those two are correlated, so it's not surprising. About 60-65% of their SSL services had some kind of misconfiguration. They had really bad certificate management. Most of their certificates had some kind of a flaw with it. They weren't running very many encrypted services, but they also weren't running very many of the risky services. So it's interesting, I think, to take a look at a single company, but here's another one. This is a third party that experienced a breach and had an effect downstream, and this is actually a pretty good company. Right? For botnet infections, they're doing well at managing their botnet infections. They had no peer-to-peer file shares going on. They had most of their services were doing well, you know, probably, 15-20% only had issues. Same on the SSL certificates. They had a lot of the encrypted services and not very many of the unencrypted. I mean, this is looking good, and they still experienced a breach, right? So this is getting at that strength of the weak signal, right? This isn't a very strong signal across these for that particular company. So what we did is we created a model. We took these 6 data points, and actually we used the botnets as the target variable, and we said, how do these other 5 help us understand or forecast how many botnet infections? And what that'll do, nobody really cares trying to forecast the botnet infections, but what it does do is it tells us the strength of the other data. And so we created this plot, and we've got this crazy math formula in there, and this is how we developed the model. But what we have is that dotted line to the right. And anything to the left of the dotted line is going to contribute to fewer botnet infections. Generally speaking, all other things held equal. Things to the right are going to be associated with more botnet infections. In other words, these are things you probably want to avoid. And this, all of these lined up to be very, very intuitive. So the very top one, when a company had no peer-to-peer, when that company was blocking peer-to-peer communication, what we saw is a huge reduction in the amount of malware that was observable. Also, reasonable services, the encrypted services. So companies that took the time to enable these encrypted services and run protected services like that have a lower amount of botnet as well. It's a good thing. The other ones are all associated with more botnets. And so if I go back to what we're trying to measure, this sense of maturity, right, we can start to make these estimations just by looking at some of these variables. We can start to put companies in sort of a good versus bad bin. Now, this study was going against botnets. And what we want to do is eventually tie all this back to breaches. Now, breaches are a very sparse and rare event, which is why it was favorable to use botnets, because that's a much more frequent event. But what we do see is that the botnet activity is associated with breaches. 68% of breached organizations that we studied had botnet activity versus 32% of the non-breached entities. So when we see that botnet activity, it's going to be more associated with breaches. And we've done variations of the study, so this is just a simplified view of that. So the next one I want to look at is attack surface. And now attack surfaces can mean a whole bunch of different things to different people, right? And what I'm going to focus on, though, is these open services, right? If we're able to scan the internet and we look at open services, what can we tell by the amount of open services and the types of open services and to the type of attack surface, right? And so we want to try and look at a large attack surface and see how is that associated with breaches. So the first thing I did is I looked at individual services. And this is looking, the dark blue are companies that experienced a breach. And this is looking at the open ports before they had the breach. And so 2.7% of breached organizations had open Postgres, which is a database server. And then less than 0.5% of the non-breached entities had that port open. So these are ports that showed up as being essentially more associated with risk, more associated with an attack surface, if you will. And so like Postgres is on there, MySQL, these are databases, right? And when I just focused on open database services, we see a huge discrepancy between there, almost twice as likely when you have these database services open. Now, I tried to take a look at this notion of attack surface, right? And the way that I measured attack surface is I looked for the number of unique services. So if you had 100 HTTP, for example, I would count that as one service, a single service. And so I came up with this plot. And so the red are non-breached entities. You can see that they peak, around 2, 3. And then it slopes down from there, whereas the green one are companies that experienced a breach. And you can see they're kind of shifted over to the right. Now, it's kind of hard to look at this and know a difference. And so I created this plot. This is a cumulative density. And the green line is companies with a breach, and the red line are those without a breach. And the way to read this is that 100% of companies had zero or more open services. And then you get to something like, if we go to 10, at 10 services, 60% of breached organizations offered 10 or more unique services compared to the 40% of non-breached. And so if you think about that, you can just see the diverging of these lines. Having more open services are associated with companies that experience more breach. In other words, there is a correlation between this attack surface, this number of open services, and being breached. So again, we're using data. Like, I think this is an intuitive finding. I don't think anybody would think this is earth-shattering. But the two things that we want to look at is, first, can we prove it? Can we establish this as a truth? And then how much more, right? Because this is one of the things that we have to decide. How much do we want to invest in scanning and reducing our attack surface? And this is somewhat significant. I mean, there's not a real close difference between these lines here. So the last one I'm going to look at is this notion of monoculture. And this is a really, really fun topic. This has been a topic in the industry for quite a while. And I'll get into the history, but think about this for a minute. When we talk about a monoculture, what we're talking about is the diversity of operating systems within a company. And so think about this, what is better for your organization, having everyone run the same operating system? And then you might get some, you know, economies of scale, you might be able to manage better, perhaps you could roll out patches faster. Or is it better to have a few operating systems to get some diversity, right? And history has taught us generally in farming and things like that, having a single monoculture, like the Irish potato famine was caused from a monoculture of potatoes, that we need some sort of diversity. And that's been the argument. This is a paper from 2003 by Dan Geer and several other pretty smart folks. And this is talking, this is they talked about across the whole industry. If we had a monopoly of Microsoft, if we had a monoculture of Microsoft, this is going to be very bad for all of us. And so in order to study this, what I did is I looked at the high-level operating systems first. I'm going to look at it in two different ways. I want to see how a monoculture affects breaches, and I want to see how a monoculture affects malware infections. And now typically, as I mentioned, those two are correlated. So if we see one going one way, we're probably going to see the other one going that way too. So this is a view. So this is looking, I think it's just under 200 million desktops. And this is from browsing data. This is from people surfing the internet, looking at that user agent string. And so this is the distribution at companies. What proportion are these different families? So a lot of companies actually obviously have a lot of Windows. Mac, when a company has Macs, it's going to be between 5 and 20% of their infrastructure. Certainly, there are companies with 100% Macs and 100% Linux. But generally speaking, the proportion of these are lower. And these are desktops, where this is not, we couldn't get data on the servers. So it's just on the desktop. So the way that we actually then measured, give some element to diversity, is we use something from biology used to measure diversity within plant life. And so this is Simpson's Diversity Index. But you can see, I wanted to create a table here that showed what diversity looked like and the type of score they got. So the first line, 565 windows, and that's it. That's a monoculture, right? Score of zero. Then on the second line, they had 2,200 windows, 100 Mac, 5 Linux, 1 Chrome. That gets about a 0.2. And so on and so forth to the bottom line, where you see it's over one, and it's very, very diverse. 968 Windows, 800 Mac, 24 Linux, 350 Chromebooks, and nothing in the other category. But that gets that's very diverse, right? So in this data, about 40% of the organizations show a perfect monoculture. And this is what we want to separate out. We want to take a look at those with a monoculture and compare them to those without a monoculture. Anybody want to guess on what we saw for breaches? Does a monoculture fare better or worse? It was a monoculture fared better when it came to breaches. And that you can explain this once you know the answer. You can explain this very intuitively, right? If a company only has one operating system, they're probably going to be very good at managing it. Responding to a breach might be easier if it's a standard platform, that sort of a thing. But what you can see in these two lines, so this is another cumulative density plot, the breached organizations start going up, and they're going up at the same rate. So even though non-breached organizations experience have more monoculture, they're going up at the same rate. And then about 0.5 and 0.75, they start to come together. And that's where I think the tipping point occurs of an unmanaged network. Now to look at malware, I wanted to go down one layer deeper, get into the actual version, right? So this is a distribution, and this is just as Mac OS X 10.12 came out, so there's not a whole lot of that. But Windows 7, obviously at the top, Windows 10, you can see we have a little bit less of a monoculture here when we go down to this different layer. But this is what we want to look at for malware. And so this is where I think intuitively we would expect monoculture to be a problem, and in fact that is the case. Now you can see these distributions on the left. Those with diversity, that it's shifted over to the left a little bit. And if you have a monoculture, the whole thing is shifted over. So it's hard to say if this company has a monoculture, oh, I bet they have a lot of botnets. What you have to say is, holding everything else equal, those with a monoculture have slightly more malware infections than those without. And you can see also on the cumulative distribution on the right that they're going up at the same rate, and they hit that point where unmanaged networks kick in and they cross over, converge. So the truth of this is, when we look at monocultures, the two things that we saw is, when compared it to breaches, those with a monoculture fared better. When we looked at botnets, they fared a little bit worse. So again, these are the weak signals that we're talking about, right? Trying to pull out some of this information. So if we're combining all of this, as we start to look at these, we're gonna start to get a really strong signal, right? This is where the strong signal is gonna come from looking at these individual things. So going back to the takeaways, hopefully I showed some of the fun science stuff that we can do. And again, this is very noisy daisy. You saw the huge distributions, right? And so there's a lot of noise in there, but we can find some of these signals, right? And like the botnet infections for monocultures, it's a weak signal. The distribution just sort of shifts over a little bit. But we can find it. We can find that little signal. We can find that weak signal. And again, hopefully, I think most of the things I talked about were rather intuitive. It lines up with our expectations, which is great, right? We shouldn't just seek out those that contradict. We want to find things that confirm, give us evidence of what we already believe, because we're going to find that point when we are humble, you know, made humble by the data. And again, learn from data. By looking at this, I think we can learn just an incredible amount. And hopefully, I had some plots in here that were probably a little bit confusing at times, but I think we need to start doing that. This is an incredibly, incredibly complex environment. And I, when I create some of these plots, I find myself having to explain it a lot, which is absolutely fine, but I think we need to start building up some data literacy, and we need to start having communications about the complexity. And I know there's a lot of things that we'll communicate and talk about where it gets simplified down. And I think that the saying was, you know, when you're working in a complex environment, you have to make things as simple as you can and no more so, right? I think that we often cross over the line and treat things a little bit too simply. So with that, I can open it up for questions. We're a little bit light, obviously, on Friday morning at 9 a.m. But if you have any questions, feel free. We've got two microphones here, and I think we've got enough people. Might be able to just raise your hand now. Yes, sir. It is commercial data for BitSight, but we do a lot of work. We'll partner with educational institutions and researchers and stuff like that, and we'll do partnerships and share data, things like that. But what we do is, once a quarter, we try to put out different research that we do. And so if there's a specific topic you want to see, you know, we can talk afterwards and hopefully get it into something coming out. Yeah. All right, well, I'll be around for a few more minutes. So thank you, everybody, for your time.